Thank you very much, Wout, and thank you very much for having me on the show. It's a pleasure to be here. I was just thinking when we were preparing about, in a way, my title, Engagement is Key, is actually a little bit conservative. I would like to make it even a little bit stronger. Engagement is the key. Engagement is not just key. So let me go into it a little bit more. So we have 50 people online. Very welcome to everybody. I see some familiar names from Spain, Poland, India even. Oh my God, brilliant. Thank you very much for taking the time to be here. So let me go into the topic a little bit. Engagement is key. Let me first show you a little statement I strongly believe in. And that's the following. So take a couple of seconds to read it. So it says, employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. Now think it quickly. I've been introducing this topic at several events lately. I've been asking people, how do you feel about the statement? Would you agree? And most people do. Like employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. Like for instance, about customer outcomes, profitability, customer satisfaction, the well-being of the company, the well-being of our colleagues and so on. So it seems a very simple statement, but it seems that reality is a little bit different. So let me go into that. And that fascinates me because I know a lot of people probably know that until 2016, I was working with Ken Schwaber at Scrum the Talk. And we've been in this topic a lot, engagement, the people aspect of Scrum. And it's so important. So when I decided to stand on my own two feet, it's almost 4 years ago, I even made it sort of a baseline of what I am as an independent Scrum caretaker and thinking about rehumanizing the workplace, something I really strongly believe in. And we have some work to do. Why? While ago, I was thinking about this idea about performance management and how to measure and increase in a way performance in the context of Scrum. And I run into this report, and you see the figures over there. It's from the Gallup, it's an institute, and it's a report that's called The State of the Global Workplace. It was published in 2017, had data analyzed from 2016, 2015. Now, the fascinating thing is that they've been updating this report regularly. So, and overall, it's pretty stable. It's slight improvement, like maybe a couple of percentages, but not really a lot. Now, what I found so honestly scary about these figures is that the Gallup Institute finds that over and over again on a global scale, 15% of all employees, people that are employed, paid by a company, are really actively engaged. Let's say positively engaged. Go for the company, do stuff, stick out their head, try out stuff, really go for it. And there's, on average, about 67, I always make it sort of 70, 75% of people worldwide are like not really engaged, not really disengaged, sort of couldn't care less, so sort of passive. As long as I get my paycheck by the end of the month, I'm sort of happy. Now, that's not too, it's not too exciting, that figure, but what is really, really scary is that globally around the world, around 20% of people are like actively disengaged. And that's scary. You're sort of being paid by a company and it's almost like you're actively working against the company. Or sort of the way I see it is sort of you've got 20% of people that are potentially undoing the great positive work of 20% of other people. And that scares the hell out of me. So thinking about performance management, well, let's focus on team engagement a lot more. Now I'm here today with Tibe in Hilversum, which is a beautiful place in the Netherlands. So just to pull out the figures of Netherlands quickly, so the Netherlands is still part of Western Europe. I think it's going to stay that for a while. And overall, Western Europe is scoring not really great. You see them on the bottom of the list. So that's sort of even more scary. Netherlands are sort of average looking at Western Europe. About 12% of people actively engaged, 75% people couldn't care less, and then only 13% of people sort of actively disengaged. Now, Belgium, and I always pull up the figures of Belgium. I'm from Belgium, so I live in Antwerp in Belgium. I always pull out the figures of most of the comfort people because we're even worse. So imagine, but it's just, what are we going to do about this? This is crazy. Imagine that you're working for a sort of medium large company. Just let's take a company of 1,000 people. This actually means that overall you can count on only 200 people out of those 1,000 people are really actively engaged, feel positive about the company, are willing to go for it, to go to the lengths of it, and so on. And it's like on average, sort of 20% of people are actively disengaged. And then that bunch of 60% of people in between that sort of couldn't care less. And I'm like, what can we do about that? So I at events, I've been asking this to people. So what can we do? What is needed to establish what we call an environment of engagement and creativity, and that probably results in innovation? So let's try and do a little poll for that. I'm hoping that you're into that. Well, can you start up the poll? So just a poll to check what you feel is needed to create, establish an environment of engagement and creativity. And I pulled up some statements, some words that people get up at events, recent events. So please go ahead, participate. Let's see what happens.
The last option of other, there wasn't any place.
There wasn't any place. Oh, okay. So Walton, I was just saying that I wanted to have some sort of option of other so that you could possibly type in your own answer, but it seems that's not possible technically. So have a look. So results coming in. Wow, thank you very much. We're about 80% of people voted. So wow, 74% of people saying trust, some mandate, some conformance, a little bit of courage too, a tiny little bit of accountability. So most people would go for trust. Okay, thank you very much. And I would agree, trust is probably very important. Now, trust is not something you just get, something you earn. It's something that you need to grow, develop a little bit. So take that into account. Now, I pulled up those words because people responded with those words at events towards me. And what I would say, what is needed first and foremost, is those things are important, but what I miss with most companies where I go out to visit and have a look around, or work with teams, work with management and so on, I miss an environment, honestly. Just an environment where people can do stuff. And that reminded me of, a while ago this year, I published an update of my book. So in 2013, I wrote a little book. It's called Scrum, a Pocket Guide. And in my pocket guide, I created a sort of Scrum game board to make visible and understandable to people that Scrum is not just, let's say, sort of the rules of the Scrum guide, because you see all of the artifacts and the events on my game board, but I wanted to add some of the core principles underlying Scrum. And still what I call today the Scrum's DNA, self-organization, empiricism, are very important, but those things and all the things you just pointed out, the accountability, the trust, the courage, to do stuff, to take a risk, to take some innovative measures, whatever, is not going to happen if a team doesn't have a established working environment. So that's what's on my Scrum game board, the artifacts, the events, and the roles of Scrum, sort of the rules in general. But I've also added some of the principles, DNA, self-organization, and empiricism, but also what I call a shared visual workspace. Teams need a workspace for their own, a dedicated team space. And that's sort of missing in a lot of organizations. So they will introduce Scrum. Scrum has a very strong focus on teamwork. And they try to do Scrum in a lot of companies' setup of open offices. And that sort of baffles me, honestly. Because open offices really great for office work, which is often not innovative, exploratory, discovery work, creating beautiful complex products with a full team. It doesn't really help if I'm sort of have a question for a colleague of mine on my team, is sort of three chairs away from me, and I have to send him a text message or an email, because if I speak too loudly, somebody is over on the other side of the room is going to look angry and annoyed at me. It's not helpful. It creates sort of information barriers. So open offices, great for office work. Really, it kills innovation and creativity. It almost kills engagement because I can't speak up. And that often combined with, I don't know how that is in your workplaces, honestly, around the world. But a lot of companies not only just have open offices, but also a clean desk policy. And I would translate that also to a clean wall policy. And walls in an innovative, creative, engaging environment should be open for people to use, put things on the wall, put post-its and use the whiteboard and go over there and have a talk and have beautiful conversations over there. So what I miss with a lot of companies is the idea of a shared, a dedicated team space. And that's not helping. So in my book also, I call that the house of Scrum. Scrum is all about transparency and inspection adaptation as the walls. Within the house of Scrum, and that could be your dedicated team space, it's all about applying the rules of Scrum, also against the principles of Scrum that we just talked about, and then lots of tactics. But it's all about collaboration. Collaboration invokes engagement. If you can't really collaborate and talk to each other, there will be no engagement. The most crazy teams with some of the best results I've ever seen in my sort of career of Agile and Scrum was where we had dedicated team spaces and it was a lot of noise inside of the room. It didn't make sense if you stood outside of the room. It totally made sense once you were in the room because you would feel the dynamics, it was a vivid, a vibrant environment where people exchanged ideas and came up with stuff. Also, I'm a big fan of pair programming. And a pair program already is all about communication, right? So I miss that in most organizations. It's one of the aspects that I've been talking about this year, 2019, a lot, sort of what creates the illusion of agility. A lot of companies try to improve their agility. They implement Scrum, they introduce Scrum, they try to adopt Scrum for that. And they often apply cookbooks, presets, scenarios that they think they can just follow. They copy paste what other people do. They go for sort of mass production. And that combined with what I see, again, that lack of team spaces. How can you properly employ Scrum, explore options, build the best possible solutions at every point in time without being able to properly communicate within the team? And even if you're working in a distributed way, let's say with some remote teams or remote team members, even then, that's why I call it on my Scrum game board, the shared visible workspace. You need a, in that case, a virtual, but you still need a workspace for the team. Might be virtual, you need online connection, 24/7 sort of communication possibilities as well. So, and that's one of the factors that leads to that illusion of agility. Because quality, time to market, whatever, doesn't really increase. Customer satisfaction doesn't increase if you don't have that engagement leading to better implementations and higher levels of innovation. And then together, to combine with some other aspects that you see here, like team instability, a lot of people outside of the teams think that they know better who should be at what team, at what point in time. So dedicated team spaces for dedicated teams, dedicated on a product or a service. So a sort of a minimal version of stability in our beautiful world of change. And what I see with a lot of Agile transformations introducing Scrum is that it's focused too much sort of at the team level and at keeping in place existing structures and silos and departments. And it led me to the conclusion that, you know what, more Agile teams does not make a more Agile organization. Agile meaning adaptive, flexible, responsive, being able to change things now in a while or regularly even. So a lot of organizations introduce Scrum, they create Scrum teams. So they just organize individuals into teams now, but it's often like sort of very small micro teams locked up in existing silos and departmental structures. A lot of synergies across teams go lost. Even the communication within teams is highly impeded and blocked and limited because they don't have a dedicated team space. So it's not really working. And actually that reminded me of an old quote by a very old paper. I don't know how many of you know it. I'm sure a lot of people do. It's called The New Product Development Game, 1986 by Taikuchi Nonaka. And already they describe what we now call sort of Scrum, the six characteristics of what we also have in the Scrum framework as we know it. So they not just left us with the name Scrum to describe our way of working, but also there's this beautiful quote in the new product development game saying, hey, organizations need to adapt a management style that promotes this process. And with this process, they meant what they called Scrum. And what we nowadays call Scrum. So nobody says how organizations should reinvent or redesign themselves, but you cannot properly implement Scrum without rethinking your organization around Scrum. Now, a lot of organizations, and I'm sort of guessing that most people will recognize that, prefer to sort of change Scrum to fit the organization, where we are sort of Scrum people thought that it was going to happen the other way around. People seeing the benefits of Scrum, seeing the value that Scrum brings, and then updating the organizational structures to get more out of Scrum. That seems to be not happening. And with our definition of Scrum, we want to stick to defining what Scrum is. We can't say how every organization should look like, but you can't introduce Scrum without adopting a management style that promotes Scrum. And that leads me to this finding. Let it sink in, so read it. Let it sink in for a couple of seconds at least. One of the biggest problems I see talking about culture, organizational culture, management culture, but certainly organizational culture, is we are still so focused on trying to control individuals. And that is a huge problem. And I'll tell you why. I just said that I worked with Ken Schreiber at Scrum the Talk from 2013 until 2016. One of the things that we spent quite some effort and time on was creating something that we called the Agility Path Framework, a framework designed and targeted at management, at organizations, leadership, also at teams. And one of the core objectives we had is when talking about management activities, performance management, judging people, assessing people, we were trying to sort of shift the focus of managers away from teams, what I call the Scrum zones, where your teams operate, your dedicated teams in their dedicated spaces, sort of stop judging those people. Look at the impact that the work is having, that those people are creating. I often compare it to sort of management being focused on performance of individuals, comparable to management being focused on sort of the power, the horsepower of your engine. So you've got this beautiful car, and we are so obsessed by upgrading, tweaking, tuning the power of the engine. And in the end, you end up with sort of a car that has sort of the horsepower of a Formula One car, but is driving on a cobblestone path, full of twists and turns, full of obstacles. So that sort of incredible, powerful engine is not helpful. So we tried to focus management, shift management focus to value, direction, goals, objectives, clear the way. So rather than focus on the engine, you're using the car to go from point A to point B. Clear the road, make sure that there's a clear road, make sure that teams know that the goal is to go from A to B. So in that sense, we try to build a framework where we try to get people to think about what is the value of our work? What is the value of the work that those teams are doing? Focus on that. Use that in Scrum terms as your primary source of inspection. And then perform an adaptation in helping the teams with skills, knowledge, practices, authorizations. Still not bashing them, assessing them, judging them. Help them do a better job when identifying what sort of the value that we're looking for. What are trends we see in increasing value? And we wanted to make it a little bit more tangible than just that, obviously. So sort of one of the rare moments in life that I tried to do something creative. We see a lot of KPIs out there, key performance indicators. The indicator aspect is lost. They turn into goals, targets even, to make it really strong. People are assessed and reviewed against that, and people call that performance management. And I, no, focus on value. And value is in general not one parameter. When I ask people about what do you think is value, then in most organizations or commercial organizations or for-profit organizations, so people always come up with something financial, benefits, profits, a bigger customer base, bigger parts of the market being captured and so on. Something with customers, customer satisfaction, customer retention, new customers gained and so on, but at least something reflected in customer satisfaction. So value for the organization via the stakeholders, benefits and so on. Value for the people for whom we actually do this, to the services that we deliver, that are delivered to. What about value for the people that have to do the work? And that's team engagement. So back in 2014, we created Agility Path. And I wanted to make it even a little bit stronger. Remember my statement? Employees who are engaged, and it's actually worldwide only 15%, actually care a lot more about customer outcomes and profitability. What if we could increase that 15% to 20% to 25% to half of our workforce? What if we can decrease the number of actively disengaged people from 20% to 15%, 10%, 5% to zero? The benefits in terms of increased customer satisfaction and profitability would be huge. So what if you would just focus on team engagement for the time being? And almost as a gift, almost as a sort of byproduct, a by-result, a by-effect of our focus on creating a better environment, rehumanizing the workplace so that people find joy, energy again in their work, in creating beautiful products and services. So what if we would do that? Focus on team engagement, forget that overly focusing, emphasizing, putting targets on financial stuff and customer satisfaction. I'm pretty convinced that we will improve the results of our organizations a lot. And just to close on that, a little quote from my book, focusing on team engagement means focusing on the people that we have. And as we all know, people are people. People are human beings. That makes us very difficult and complex to work with, but also beautiful. But people are not resources. So if ever you would be able to inspire your organizations, your management, your stakeholders, your leadership to focus on team engagement, manage the environment rather than managing the people, please start with the base point, the base view that people are not resources. People are not robots. People are not cogs or replaceable pieces of machinery. Treat people as people. And let's think about the incredible contradiction in HR, human resources. I won't do the job. So that was sort of my story. It's how I believe in, let's try to manage for team engagement. And as a result, almost as a gift, you will get higher profitability and higher customer satisfaction. So let's go into some questions. We still have about 25 minutes to go, 24 minutes to be really exact. So let's see whether we have some questions. Walt, have you been able to keep up to date on questions? Let's have a look.
Alexander. Crazy bit.
Okay. So looking up questions quickly. Alexander Loos.
Alexander is de onderste van mijn knopje.
Oh. Yep. So, Alexander, thank you for the question, Alexander Oussel. I believe that a team's level of engagement is tightly linked to the company's culture. How do we change a company's culture to increase employees' engagement? That's absolutely right, Andrea. It is indeed tied to company's culture. And can I add to that, I'm really happy that you call it company or potentially organizational enterprise culture. Because, you know, the word culture often makes people think about regions, parts of the world. You know, in that part of the world, they can't do this as well. No, if we start by acknowledging that every individual person, every individual has the intrinsic ability to organize its own, her own work, that's a big start. It's often what is impeding people to go for self-organization. What is sort of my main challenge is, and I don't know how that helps you in your question, honestly, how do we change the company's culture to increase employees' engagement? I like to turn things around a little bit. What can we do to take away everything that blocks, impedes people from actually engaging? And you know, Scrum thrives a lot on self-organization. The minimal level of self-organization that you look for in Scrum is that at least a Scrum team organizing its own work within a sprint. So self-organization happens within boundaries. So having clear boundaries is certainly helpful. Goals, a product vision, objectives, things you want to reach. And then sort of, and that's the difficult challenge to get across to people that are sort of owning a company, managing a company, middle management as well. Focus on boundaries, not on the people. And help people see that you get a lot of control in Scrum from the boundaries, having a potentially releasable result by the end of every 2 or 3 weeks. But I have no magical solution to help you do that. It's hard work, it's going step by step. It's augmenting the idea of self-organization in Scrum. What I like a lot with Scrum and self-organization is to uplift self-organization. So as a starting point, move towards real minimal level of self-organization, allowing a team to organize its own work in a sprint. And then as a Scrum Master and a product owner, work with stakeholders to get that message out all the time. When thinking about value, try to make your sprint review about the question, how much potential value has this team created in a sprint? Rather than has every individual in the team lived up to completing his or her tasks. So try to get stakeholders to get into that mode. At Scrum Master and Product Owner work, make that sure that sprint review is about potential value delivered by the team in a sprint. That makes a difference. And then increase that level of self-organization. If people can organize their own work within a sprint, they can also design their own team. So allow teams to come up with, oh, we need additional skills, we need additional people in the team. So that's sort of the positive side of the medal. And maybe also the negative side, facilitate, coach, help teams. So maybe that's a new role for HR, facilitating teams, supporting teams in designing their own team. Meaning we're having troubles within the team with conflicts and so on. As a group of adult people, you can manage that yourself. So the message is, Andrea, go for the minimal level of self-organization in Scrum. A team organizing its own work in a sprint and stakeholders only visiting the sprint review, not interrupting, disrupting, whatever, a sprint, and then try to uplift that. So dedicated teams in a dedicated team space, organizing their own work and also deciding who should be on and maybe even more difficult, who should not be on our team. And that will create engagement. It connects a lot to, I don't know, most people probably know the theory or the ideas of the research of Daniel Pink. It connects a lot to increasing the level of autonomy, you know, in complex cognitive work. Once we get the matter of money off our heads, it's off the table, we can focus on the work. And what really motivates people is autonomy, mastery, and purpose. So make sure that people have purposeful work, building a product for real customers is certainly purposeful, I believe, via product vision, objectives, challenges, and so on. Mastery, give people time to become better at what they do. Also go for something I believe, and that's also in the new product development game. Try to transcend cross-functional teams and make them, inspire them to go for cross-fertilization. People learning from each other, people acquiring new skills by learning from each other. And then autonomy, like self-organization, self-designing, and so on. And to close on your question, Andrea, and a lot of people that might be listening, bring that message to managers all the time, relentlessly. Try to move step by step by step. Repeat at every sprint you what it is about, why it is there, what's the goal, what should be that core question, value, and so on. And then prepare for probably a long journey.
That's how I made it. Yeah.
Well, Sander, you have this question on, can you give me some experience, insights of how to get the conversation with MTs? I'm a little bit in a fortunate position, Sander, honestly. So before I engage with an organization, I have sort of three prerequisites in mind. And one is, it has to be personal. I have to know people and so on. I don't participate in bids and procedures and RFPs and so on. It has to be about Scrum, because it's the only thing I know a little bit about, not too much, but still. And it has to be serious. And in that sense, my way of checking whether an organization is serious about working with me is to go in and feel, is there an urgency? And do I get access to the management team, the CXO team, the board of directors, whatever? And that's also my starting question when I work with them. I stay away from all sort of technicalities of Scrum, not the roles, the rules, or whatever, the product owner. No. Just why are we here? So I try to connect with problems that the MT sees. What's urgency? What are we trying to resolve? Is it customer satisfaction? Is it quality? Is it the fact that we are continuously losing the best people in the organization? They all seem to go away, and it seems to be very difficult to make ourselves attractive to really great new people. Is it connection with teams? Is it connection with the customer base? So I always try to go for urgency. What's the sense of urgency? And then maybe go into, okay, if that's the problem, let's see how we can do that with Scrum. So that sort of, I talked about inspection and adaptation. So inspection in general, in a regular situation, should be inspecting the value that you're creating and then adapting how you're working and engaging people to do that. That illusion of agility, that's also just the inspection. It's an observation. What should we do about it? I try to go in with management teams and talk about urgency, sense of urgency, seriousness, and then make it small again. Let's take one initiative, the most burning initiative, the most important product, a project, whatever, preferably a product, and that's what I call, that's the adaptation based on observation, illusion of agility, adaptation. Let's reimagine your Scrum. What's the product that they're working on? Is that really an end-to-end product? Does it deliver end-to-end value? Do you really have a real product owner? Do you have a dedicated team? Do you have a dedicated team space? Does the team have all the authorizations, the tools, the skills to produce releasable increments? And we're not going to do that for all agile teams. No, more agile teams does not make a more agile organization. One initiative at a time. Let's take a number of sprints and learn. And maybe if that's comforting to you, Sander, I'm not successful. I don't get that message across to people. A lot of organizations want to go faster. It's too slow. And then after 3-4 years, hard wake up call, it's not working. And maybe in the end, some people will start listening. So even when I get access to the management team, which is a sort of prerequisite, otherwise I will not engage with the organization, So, and as a Scrum Master, Product Owner, certainly Scrum Master, try to sort of open that door so you can do the same. Look for urgency, look for the sense of urgency, reflect on how they're doing Scrum, and try to get them to reimagine their Scrum initiative after initiative after initiative. In the 3-4 years that I've been actively doing that, I only found one organization that was sort of willing to do that. The other ones think, no, slow, it's not going fast enough. Still, it's my profound belief, it's based on my experience, my observations of result, that's the way to go. I hope that was helpful.
Continue with the questions. There's
yep.
quite a lot still. It's Ira. Ira.
You want a question?
Oh, you can bear these two to mind.
Oh, okay. So there's a question from Egor. Hi, Egor. We know each other, right? How can we keep engagement of teams of technicians who care a lot about timing and coding activities instead of the Scrum meetings and so on? Yeah, that's a maybe a difficult one, but it sort of goes back to the idea, two topics. Development in Scrum is all work needed to create releasable versions of products. And I would hope that any product development professional is engaged by that, that engages them. That's what they want to do, create great, beautiful products of high quality, regularly being able to increase customer satisfaction. So you would wonder about just the technical part of development is not enough. If that doesn't engage people, you might wonder whether they're sort of sitting in the right place. That's one aspect. But it's like you said, the events of Scrum, I call them consciously events, because a lot of teams see them indeed as meetings. It goes back to that open office setup again. A lot of teams have to do their events in meeting rooms because you can't do it in an open office location. You have to do it in meeting rooms, and that turns them into meetings already. They set up an agenda for that, limited in time, 1 hour, because then somebody's knocking at the door, kicking you out of the meeting room. So people don't see it as events anymore. And organizations introduce Scrum not as a way to eliminate a lot of existing meetings and replace them with the Scrum events. So sort of lower the number of meetings and still have the Scrum events in place. So that sort of creates a lot, there's a lot of awareness that we have to create. The meetings of Scrum are events to inspect and adapt, and development is more than just technical work. Probably you need a good product owner with a great product vision, boundaries, goals in place, objectives, and so on. It's not an easy one, but certainly a very worthwhile. So Simon Meyer, I'm looking at your question. I hope I gave you a lot of things that I think what is stopping people from actually engaging. No team spaces, delivery pressure, So I've been working with a lot of middle management and management teams, CXO teams, and I sort of try to gently, I'm Belgian, we do stuff gently. I try to confront them with the idea that, yeah, but you're imposing deadlines and deadline pressure. It's just the old way of working. So it invites people to still be quick, quick, quick. Just that sort of idea, quick, quick Scrum. It takes out all of the oxygen of teams. No room to think, no room to reflect, no room to innovate, not even to refactor. So that's sort of the awareness. So delivery deadlines, no dedicated team spaces, no room for teams to design themselves. So people are getting pulled out of a team by resource people or project management officers and so on. Those are the aspects that sort of impede and block people to actively engage. So, Danilo Silva, I'm looking at your question, how to have visibility of goals and so on if you have a partly partly remote team or distributed team. That's why, again, on my Scrum gameboard, I called it a shared visual workspace. It has to be a shared workspace. It can be virtual. That means you might have a team room in one location, a team room in a second location with an online, full-time, real-time video connection open all the time. That might be a setup. You can put things on the wall in one room with the camera on it, or take pictures, share it with people. You don't need necessarily digital tools for that. You can do it really dynamic, but it starts by having that shared visual workspace. meaning shared workspace, that teams can sort of decorate in a visual way so that they create information radiators, share that with each other, don't have to clean the desks and the walls every night, just maybe every fortnight, every 3-4 sprints, because that sort of chaos, that sort of messy feeling is important. That's important to invoke engagement. So I hope that gives you a lot of things that you might want to use. Yes, we're looking at the time, by the way, so I think we're doing fine. So Marloes de Haan, I'm sort of assuming you're from the Netherlands based on your name. So we just moved into this beautiful open office with clean desk and wall policies. What would you recommend to take the first step to change this environment? As an HR coach, go talk to management. So what I've seen happening over the past 6-7 years, also Belgium, the Netherlands, but also other countries in Europe, we went from one extreme to another one. We had all these sort of cubicle setups, like really individual workspaces with walls, and that was blocking communication. And they moved into the other extreme, open offices. So I believe in a model somewhere in between, where you have a mix of environments, open offices, right types of work, individual things for individual calls, and getting out of the rat race now in a while and just sit and think or do telephone calls. And in between is something like team spaces. So I've been talking to management people at large organizations. Try to install dedicated team spaces where teams have a fixed space where they can decorate and so on. Because innovation, engagement is all about communication, interaction, people exchanging ideas. It's another thing. So you have the levels of self-organization. You also have sort of things like levels of conflict. And even in the new product development game, it was already one of the core characteristics of more successful product development teams, built-in instability. You need exchange of ideas, different options being discussed. You need that sort of freedom within a team to talk about different possibilities. And open offices just don't inspire and even limit people to do that. So dedicated team spaces. And Marloes, honestly, I want to share, it's one of the most difficult discussions I had, because often the way that offices are set up is being, and that's not being really done, let's say, in a self-organizing way. It's not a self-organizing decision. Meaning a lot of organizations sort of forget to involve people in the office setup or the new office setup. It's just people by the top looking at other organizations, copy-paste behavior. They just go for open offices blindly without consulting with the people that are actually having to work in those offices. So talk with them, dedicated team spaces, incredibly important. So looking at a couple of questions.
Ira, her name is Ira, and that's probably the last.
Ira. Oh, Ira. Okay, Ira, how can we, so Ira Kotik, I hope I'm saying that right. You have the honor of having the last question, if that's an honor. How can we drive the engagement? Do you have specific steps? No, hard work, step by step. I was recently talking and working with a Scrum Master, and sort of inspiring that Scrum Master to try to get sort of a foot in the door at the management team via the development manager, the IT manager, whatever. A challenge for a lot of Scrum Masters. Scrum Masters are what we call change agents for the organization. So not servant leaders just for the team, product owner and development team, but also in that sense, responsible, accountable for almost updating the organization to get more out of Scrum. And the challenge for Scrum Masters is to be recognized for somebody as a leader, not just a servant, but also a leader with regards to Scrum. So being seen as a point of contact for the whole organization, with all topics regarding Scrum. So, and that's a challenge. So as a Scrum Master, besides all the things that we talked about, dedicated team spaces, thinking about the question, what is our product? I'm working with the team, setting boundaries and so on, but also as a Scrum Master or a coach, make yourself known, getting yourself recognized as somebody with a lot of insights into what Scrum is and how to make Scrum better for people.
All the way at the bottom, there's two more questions, Igor again and Kelly.
Yeah. Okay, Kelly, let me pick up your question. So Kelly Hessels, hi. How to deal with the team if you don't give pressure deadlines, but the team is focusing too much on technical perfection and that is impacting delivery? I totally recognize what you described, Kelly. It's sort of the old behavior. You know, I like to say that Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. You can implement the process, follow the rules, have the meetings or the events in place, and still not get the results that you were hoping for. We have been treating people in that sort of behavior, we have been inviting people to show that behavior for decades in a row by pressing them, deadlines, individual performance reviews every year, which is not helpful for better team behavior often. So it's going to take a while before people free up from that old pressure. So strange finding is, and I think you've seen it happening, that I think that also led maybe to your question. We see a lot of people, we go in, we even if we allow them to really self-organize and even take out external pressure, that people still put that pressure onto themselves. It's like they're wanting to be instructed. But if you had to work like that for 10, 20, 50, whatever years, it's going to take a while to get over that. Because in the past, every time we said, you can take your own decisions, and it didn't turn out the way that management liked it, their heads were chopped off. So people stopped doing that. It's going to take a while before people pick up on that. Keep your trust in people, keep up the respect for people that they can actually do that. Bring it up every retrospective. Open questions at the retrospective. Hey, what was our focus on technical perfection? Did that help? How was it about value? How did it contribute to a better team result? So keep using the retrospective and based upon your trust that, hey, you're a beautiful team. You can actually do this. I trust you for that. Yeah. So, Igor, one more question. What about games? Well, I have this little, it's very personal, difficulty with games. I'm not a games person at all. I like to have great conversations with people, serious conversations. Now, there are games out there that can actually help. There are retrospective techniques that can actually help. So, certain techniques, games, whatever, in a retrospective, nice. But don't forget, it's not about the game. It's not about the technique you're applying. It's about, at a retrospective, two core questions for me. One, what have we delivered? Was it actually done? Were we able to release it into production? Yes, what can we do more? No, oh, what can we do next sprint to actually achieve that level? So thinking about done, that's one question. And the second question is, how did we feel as a team? Sort of measure, self-measure your engagement as a team. And if you want to use games and techniques for that, fine, but start with those questions. So don't make the retrospectives about the techniques, but about using your techniques to reveal answers and options on those questions. So thank you all very much for being here. You've been 53 people across the planet. I've seen some familiar names. Really happy that you're here. I hope you liked it, enjoyed it.
Oh, yeah.
One more question. Oh, Wal says me one more question. So, thank you, Alexander. You thanked me. That's great. So, Vladislav, let me go into your book. One more question quickly. How to deal with team member behavior when they are overestimate or do less work versus deadline? Do not want to change that and so on. How to help them not to keep lying? That's a great thing. As a Scrum Master, ask questions. There's this thing called velocity. If you use it properly, it might still be a good practice. If you measure how much work you actually got done in previous sprints, ask your team, why are you pulling in work into the next sprint that is, let's say, substantially higher than what reality told you you can actually do? So sort of feed it back to the team, reflect, be a mirror to the team. And you talked about team member behavior. Focus not so much on individual members, focus on the team. How do you as a team feel about that? And dig into, why do you do that? Why do you pull more work into the sprint than you can actually deliver? Because the past is short, the future is always uncertain. The past has shown you how much work on average you can do. So reflect, help them think for that, ask open questions, re-establish the idea of properly working with velocity and not sort of the external pressure. So maybe that helps you. So I hope this was a really helpful session for you. I liked it a lot. I'm very passionate about people and the human side of Scrum. I hope this helped you at least a little bit. So thank you for being here. If you're on the other one side of the planet, have a great day ahead of you. If you're on the other side of the planet, enjoy your night, your evening, some time off. Go have a great time. Thank you. See you next time.
So yeah, Gunther,
thank you so much.
If there's one clear explanation of engagement, it's probably the energy in this webinar, because an engaged audience gives the best of energy. You've been such amazing crowd asking all these questions, and thank you, Gunther, for the very clear and passionate talk. It's up to me to close it all off. It's a bit more engaging if I show myself to the world. Thank you so much, everybody attending and asking the questions. For all you watching, don't forget to check out all the trainings that Gunther has to offer. Check out the website xibia.com/academy. And as promised, we are excited to give you your bonus. It's not really a big thing. I hope you enjoy it as a probably a Christmas gift. By email, you receive a one-time voucher discount, which you can use for booking any of our training courses in the first quarter of 2020. Please have a look at the website. And if it's not all, we started something new. We build a little exclusive community. A hub, an online place for you for infinite learning, interacting, and resources, and you are the first to be invited. All recordings from the Xibia Academy webinar week will be available in the community, including this webinar. You will receive your personal and free invites once all the recordings are available. Just please allow us a little bit of time to upload all of the recordings we have during the webinar week. In the meantime, continue your learning journey at xibia.com/academy, or select your perfect learning sprint with all the other webinars we've got to offer this week. Check out xibia.com/webinar week. That was it. See you again during the next episode of a webinar, or the next episode of the Academy webinar week, which will take place mid or end of May, probably in 2020. Thank you again so much. Thanks for watching.